Good evening. Tonight we pay tribute to South African musical heroes Abdullah Brigham, Huma Sikela, Kaifa Semenya, Jonas Gwangwa, Leta Mbulu, and Miriam Makeba. They used their music to spread the ills about apartheid when they were in exile. How appropriate tonight as we celebrate Freedom Day. During his 14 years in self-imposed exile from South Africa, pianist Abdullah Ibrahim's passionate compositions boomed like anthems to the world. He so aptly once stated, "His music effectively interprets the feelings of the voiceless in South Africa who have been forced into exile. It reflects their pain and courage." Let's hear him now as he plays Sketches from a Lifetime. To this mic, I just want to ask a few questions. You know, I was reading about you, and The Guardian in London rightfully called you one of the best bred jazz pianists in the world.
I think so.
Yeah. this music takes me back to Sophiatown. If I may say, those days I used to call you Uncle Dollar. You're playing with my uncle, Eli Mabuza, living at my home in Sophiatown. And you'd go into the garden, quiet moments by yourself. But I don't want to talk about those days. I want to talk more about your days overseas in exile. Why did you, I mean, it was a self-imposed exile. You did not have to be there. You could have stayed here and made a name for yourself, or you could, which you did, by the way, or you could have just stayed overseas and really made a lot of money.
When something is necessary to do, we don't need to be thanked for it. And when the African National Congress asked us to take a more visible and positive role in terms of the struggle, it was immediate response for us. Our lives are not better than any others are African.
When you asked, were you, are you homesick, you said yes, but not for what is there now. We are homesick for a democratic society, the South Africa of all the people, regardless of race, creed, or color.
Life in exile was horrible. The worst thing I remember from exile is waking up, is going to sleep at night and dreaming that you're at home.
Mm.
No?
And waking up and finding...
And waking up and finding that reality. That was the harshest moments of our lives. But we took cue from it, knowing that we would be successful.
You played with the best in the world, Duke Ellington. By osmosis, did you get all of that?
Well, Duke for us was never an American. Even when I first started playing music in this in South Africa. I see brother Joe Mahotsi in the audience.
Yeah, we're
going
to be talking to him as well.
One of the Manhattan Brothers. That was my first professional. That was my first professional job. At Ellington, to us, was never an American. He was just a wise old man in the village. And the greatest musician going into the 21st century, jazz, classic, whatever. And meeting Ellington was a... It was a learning experience for us, like one classical players would study Bach or Beethoven. Our man is Ellington.
Because of time, obviously. Just the chorus of Manningberg, because it's going to take me back to see him. I want to just go back to where my uncle Ellie is right now.
Well, play a snatch of it. Manningberg has changed.
Has it changed? Let's hear it. Let's hear it. Let's get down for it. Abdullah Ibrahim, thank you. Thank you. Other artists who made history were Kaifa Semenya and Leta Mbulu. Miriam Makeba became their mentor. Together they performed in King Kong. Later they left South Africa for America with Sponono. Abigail, you sang with Kaifas, you sang with Leta.
Yes, I did.
King Kong.
Oh yes, yes I did.
King Kong.
Brave as a lion. King Kong. Ufana nemfene.
King Kong.
Brave as a lion. King Kong, king of them all, King Kong, king of the people, uh-huh. I'm him, that's me, King Kong.
Oh, okay. You know who this is? This is Joe Mokgotsi, and Joe Mokgotsi, King Kong days. Kaifas was also in King Kong and Leta, weren't they?
Yeah.
Leta was what again? Well, she was the young girl.
She was the youngest in the whole cast.
Mm-hmm.
And she played, she was singing and dancing. We used to dance together and sing. And she was just wonderful. She had a group, she was singing with a group called the Swanky Spots. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
There was a time you also ended up having to take over the lead role in King Kong.
Oh, yeah.
What happened there?
Oh, shame. Big sister just suddenly got ill.
That's Miriam.
Miriam, of course, yeah. And they asked us to audition, and I did. And I didn't know that I knew her dialogue. I knew most of her songs. It was a miracle. And then my kid said, yes, we've got Joyce. I said, who? Me? I mean, I was young. I was 17. I was in tears. And I was just told, you're going on, you're going to play the part because you know it. I said, I don't, with Megan and Diaz, I cannot. I said, you are going to do it, you know it.
But that was an honor. That was...
I know, she said, but then I was young. I was shaking. I was scared. I didn't know who I was, you know. I wasn't anybody. I mean, I used to admire what Joe, but Nathan, you know, Miriam to me was the lady.
I mean, I tell you,
was this star. Mm-hmm. And me, having to play her part, I said, no ways.
We're going to be talking to Miriam later on. Okay. But another legendary South African musician whose music literally roared all over the world in those days when folk were in exile was Jonas Gwangwa. In fact, before Jonas came on, the camera folks said to me, what is he going to play? And the one said, Zonke Zimnandi, they're all good. Anyone. So let us hear Jonas playing Dipororo.
Thank you. Fred Johnny Hanet.
All right.
On Doji Dai Dai.
Yeah, sure.
And Dube.
Yeah, right.
To come here and dance peel.
Yeah, with your late brother, uncle.
Yeah, Uncle Kiss Man, my uncle, how? Wow! You know, I sat there, listened to the words.
I suppose, yeah.
Tell the people what you were saying. There are some other people who don't understand Sotho. I was just mesmerized.
Well, Diphororo is waterfalls, but in this case here, it's waterfalls of tears from the parents whose children have not come back from exile. A lot of children have left, and to this day, there's still a whole lot of them who haven't come back. And it is not known whether they are alive, whatever they be, or, you know, they just don't want to come back, or they're unable to. You know, but this is the sad story of South Africa. And they are being missed, of course.
Exile life. You in exile for how long?
30 years exactly. I left here with King Kong also in 1961, and I came back in 1991.
You'll notice throughout the program, I want people to also tell me about the funniest thing that happened to them in exile. I know that there was so much suffering, but the funniest things, there are some funny moments.
Miriam was leaving for Newport, but when she saw me, she was shocked because she had never seen me so thin and scrawny. I mean, I couldn't cast a shadow. She said, "Quang, quang, what's wrong? You know, what's wrong with this woman? Okay, you know." And, you know, I couldn't sleep, I couldn't do anything. She finally sent me to her doctor, said, "You gotta go and see my doctor in Park Avenue." So I went to Park Avenue, and I'm sitting there, and people keep coming in and going out. And I say, "Oh, apartheid again, eh?" See all these women coming in, going out. I mean, I'm sitting there, and then finally the doctor says, "Now you, how can I help you, my friend?" And I had this stomachache, you know. She said, "You know, this stomach." And the women who were sitting there, you know, they were laughing at me, you know. And I said, "Hey, Zimala." You know what had happened, actually? Miriam had sent me to her gynecologist.
So, oh my gosh. Anyway. So, did the gynecologist see you?
Yeah, well, he referred me.
But Ray, you're mic'd up there. Did Gwangwa have any influence on your music?
I would say, to me, they never really left because their music kept us going and we kept on just listening to the hidden messages in their nuances and the notes. And if I'm not mistaken, most of all the young dudes of the 80s and the late 70s benefited quite a lot from the music that we usually got when we visited Zimbabwe, Mozambique, and Botswana, because we couldn't get the music here at home. Like, moreover, the Union of South Africa, it was so difficult to get it. Hence, some of the singers who started coming out singing in three-part harmonies were really influenced by the Union of South Africa, which was Ubra Gwangwa, Siminya, and Othai Hugh.
Into any influence from the Shiros and Heroes of music?
Yeah, I remember I was still very young when I heard Miriam and Letta, or Sis Miriam and Sis Letta, I'm sorry. In those days, they used to play a lot of Western music in our radios, but my parents had records like the Gwangwas, the Hughes, the Gebers, the... Okay. But the most interesting thing is that I wanted to be a singer. And then I used to sing out of tune, though. So I don't know, you know, how I thought I was going to make it as a singer.
Did you ultimately master that?
I think so.
Let me hear
I'm
that.
A singer now.
Let me hear how you mastered it. I'm trying to get to you to say something.
Okay. Okay. Tula stand or sam. Tula stand or
sami tula stando Saint Lizio. Yeah. Yay.
After the break, we talk to Hugh Masekela. In Miriam Makeba's book, Makeba, My Story, she says, in the orchestra is a young man named Hugh Masekela. Huey and I have been friends for years, ever since he was 14 and a student at Huddleston Boys School. Father Huddleston went to America and came back with musical instruments. When Huey took the trumpet and looked at it, guess what was on the bell? Louis Armstrong's name was etched into the brass. That was the beginning of Huey's career. We're going to be talking to Huey after this, but before that, I'd like him to play a song that he says was really named after his mother, Paulina. And I think that's a song he composed when he was in exile about his mother, Paulina and Huey. Hugh, a tear even dropped as you played that song. Tell us the significance of that song.
Well, my mother died in 1978 after she had finished visiting myself and my sister Barbara in Los Angeles, and we hadn't seen her for 18 years. And a month after she came back from a three-month visit to us in the States, she died in a motor car accident, and we both couldn't come and bury her. I was sitting with Dudu Pukwane one day in his house in London, you know, and telling him the story, and he said, "Ah, let's write a song." And so I actually wrote this song with Dudu Pukwane. May his soul rest in peace too.
You know, when you're playing a trumpet, obviously we don't know what the words are that you're trying to tell us. Tell us roughly, what are you saying in the song? We know Paulina.
You know, when I'd received the telegram that my mother had died, I was actually in Liberia, and I read it over and over, because the word died, I kept thinking maybe, you know, it was something that she fell or she's sick. Or it never changed. And I still have the telegram, you know, I have it framed, because it's still hard to believe. Certain people never die, you know, they just stay with you forever. And she seems to be around. But I think that musicians were just instruments of, you know, people used to say, "When did you write that song?" I said, "I didn't write the song. It was sent to me, or it came to me." Mm. So to a certain extent, I feel maybe it's her voice calling back at me, you know, saying, she used to call me boy, boy.
And she wanted you to be a doctor, by the way. Can you believe you a doctor? But anyway.
I would be a very good doctor and make my patients laugh. And I might get them well, right?
Which one would you have wanted to be? What type of doctor?
A gynecologist.
I knew that. How did I know that? How did I know that? Gwangwa goes to a gynecologist by mistake. He wants to be a gynecologist. The funny moments in Exile.
You know, me and Jonas, we're cousins, but we grew up together and we're very close. And, you know, in the townships even now, like boys, you'll see them walking together holding hands. So I hadn't seen him for like a year and a half, and he finally arrives and I said, "Exa, who's that fana?" So like he holds my hand and I said, leave my hand, you can't do that here.
That is true, you cannot.
He said, "Why, man?" And I said, "Just don't leave it, I'll explain it later, but don't."
Dizzy Gillespie. Who are the others who had influence on you? You guys used to go and eat at Dizzy's place, huh?
Well, when I came to the States, Dizzy had already adopted Miriam, you know, and they'd been sending me records and a lot of gifts. And Dizzy introduced me actually to everybody. He was like a surrogate father to us. And we got our first home with Miriam when we got married, we lived across the street from Dizzy Gillespie, because he got us the house.
Many people don't know that you're married to Miriam.
Yeah, for a long time. But we lived across the street from him, and for a long time I thought Dizzy really liked me, but what I found out, he said, "Come on, live next to me," is that he didn't drive. And we lived in the suburbs, and every time he said, "Listen, man, can you just ride me downtown to New York?" We lived in New Jersey, you know. So I drove him just about everywhere, but he was so helpful. I mean, the greatest thing is when I arrived in New York, I had this fashionable, small, little Italian raincoat. So I didn't know, you know, this would be above the knee. And Dizzy looked at me and said, "You're going to freeze here, nigga, with that thing. It's cold here." So he said, "Let me tell you something. Why you meet me downtown at Weber and Heilbronner's tomorrow at 1 o'clock? I'll be waiting outside on 57th and Broadway." So I went there and I was looking for Dizzy. He wasn't there. And the shopkeeper came and said, "Are you Maskila?" Said, he says, "Come in here." Dizzy said, "I should give you this." It was like a camel hair Mexicoat, brown Mexicoat with a belt. And inside he said, "You're going to freeze, nigga."
About your worst moments in Exile.
Why do you always do that in a soprano? Tell us about it. I always wanted to ask you that.
You know, because that means that I'm coming with a bomb after that. So I thought I try to go up, when I hit the bomb, it might not hit us.
Is that why I'm perspiring so much?
It's the effect I have on you.
Okay,
here.
Well, baby. Yeah, talk to me. I mean, talk to me.
At least See what I do? I make him cry, if nothing else. After the break, we continue to talk to Miriam Makeba, who was revered by kings, presidents, and legends of international music. Thanks, you.
Thank you. Thank you, thank you.
Mother Africa, the Empress of African Song, that's Miriam Makeba. She is the dynamic ambassador of African song who took the history, the struggle, and the songs of Africa to the international world. And she educated the world about the injustices of apartheid. Let's hear her singing her first song, Don't Divide Us.
Do you hear me, my brothers? Do you hear me, my sisters?
Miriam, in the audience here tonight, first let me say the Tanzanian ambassador, which was the first country to give you a diplomatic passport, sends his regards. He wishes he was here, but his 10-year-old daughter has a birthday. But he said, we were the first country. But in the audience, too, are other ambassadors who came from different countries where you've traveled and where you sang and where they felt your music meant so much to them. From the Ivory Coast, a few words to Miriam.
I just want to say that thank you very much, Miriam, for being part of our life and making us able to follow the struggle right from the distance. And we really appreciated everything you did to our youth, to our female artists in Cote d'Ivoire. And I think everybody is very, very happy about you and what you did for the country. Thank you very much for what.
From Guinea?
Yes, what I can say as the ambassador of Guinea, I can only tell the story. I present my credential on 27th of June 1996 to His Excellency President Mandela. And I told him, Guinea has already an ambassador in Pretoria. He asked me who. I say Miriam Makeba. Oh. So what I only say, Miriam was a Guinean. She is a Guinean. She will be a Guinean forever.
From Tunisia.
Thank you. Well, Miriam to us is really not the singer. She is the symbol of Africa, and I think Mama Africa is really the best word that represents Miriam to all of us. That we are very, very proud to have been associated with Miriam Makeba, and that Tunisia has been a place where Miriam has always found, I hope, you know, warmth and friendship. And it is also with great pride that we know that she holds Tunisia's highest decoration for cultural merit.
Wow. Yeah.
Now, Miriam Makeba has meant more to us as a person who epitomized the struggle not only of South Africa, but in its own way, those of us Black Americans, African Americans, who so identify with this continent and what this woman stood for. And as my colleague has said, the humility of this woman is something that was so impressive to us in the States. And I think that very few people have appreciated the kind of agony, the sorrow, the pain that she has gone through. Because in so many ways, what it epitomizes, not just the sorrow of this one woman, but the sorrow of a nation, the sorrow of Black people everywhere, and this one woman carried that burden for us so well and with such great dignity. Mm-hmm. She will always be beyond a hero to us, beyond a shiro. She will epitomize what this struggle has always been about.
Mm. Marlon Brando said to you once, when you sing, you become a lioness. When you are off stage, you are so soft-spoken and shy. I want to talk to you a little bit more. From Morocco.
Thank you, Felicia. You mentioned lioness. In Morocco, our symbol is lion. We couldn't be lions if we didn't come from lioness. Miriam Makeba, my colleagues, mentioned what she inspired to all of us. And before becoming ambassador, my first hearing about the struggle of South Africa against apartheid was when I was a member of soccer team and we won the Mandela Cup. It was a tournament in solidarity with South African struggle. And the second strong message we had was from Miriam Makeba's song. And we were always fighting with our African colleagues when we were students in France from Guinea, from Cote d'Ivoire, from Tunisia, from somewhere, from everywhere in Africa, not only those who are present, but we were all from Morocco saying, no, Miriam Makeba belonged to us.
And finally, from Uganda.
Well, Felicia, Miriam Makeba represents to us the epitome of the best of the African, in the African woman. The African woman, as you know, also represents the best in the universal woman, because she has the quality and fortitude and the ability to rise above all these problems. Thank you very much.
After you've heard all that has been said about a woman I admire greatly, my Shiro in many ways, she set fashion trends. I mean, I read the book and I read the reviews about Miriam. That hairstyle, you guys remember, it became the Makeba look in America. Remember the short afro? She set the trend in Miriam. But while I have you here, what was the toughest moment for you in exile?
The toughest moment for me in exile was the death of my daughter. Mm.
You say she was all I had, she and I against the world. Sing one verse of that song about your mom.
Of things I should be thankful for, I've had a goodly share. And as I sit here in the comfort of a cozy chair, my fancy takes me to a humble east side tenement, three flights up in the rear to where my childhood days were spent. It wasn't much like paradise, but amid the dirt and all, there sat the sweet one that I fondly called my wonderful mama. I need her more than ever now, my wonderful mama. I long to kiss her wrinkled brow. I long to hold her hands once more, as in days gone by, and ask her to forgive me for things I did to make her cry. How few were her jewels. She never cared for fashion styles. Her jewels and treasures, she found them in her baby's smile. Oh, I know what I am today, to that dear little lady. so old and gray, to that wonderful, wonderful mama, mama.
Ladies and gentlemen, I don't have any more to say. Maybe we should end it on that note and say good night. The story of Miriam Makeba touches the hearts and souls of everyone. Watch out for the next program with Miriam Makeba, based on her book, Makeba, My Story, The Joys, the Pain, the Sufferings of Life in Exile with Miriam Makeba. Has a member of your family been a victim of a serial killer? Do you believe that you narrowly escaped being a victim of a serial killer? Call us, we want to talk to you. The police are often criticized, but people forget the hardships that they endure. Has your spouse been killed in the line of duty? Has he or she committed suicide because of the stress of the job? Has it ruined your marriage? Are you disillusioned? Write to us at FMS Productions, P.O. Box 29896, Melville 2109. Or call us on 011-880-1864.